And welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen. If you see Donna giggling and me giggling, we've had fun in behind the scenes. It was one of those personnel kind of things, you know. But we were enjoying. We always enjoy ourselves when we get together, don't we, Donna?
We do. And sometimes Jim makes me laugh so hard I start snorting. And when I start snorting, it's all over for Jim.
Oh yeah. I'm down for the count then. And ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Messages of Inspiration and Hope. It's proudly brought to you today by the good guys at the 6MinuteWebinar.com. And before we get into the show and before we get everything rolling, I just want to say how grateful and appreciative I am for all of the folks out there who listen to the show and share the show with others. We really do appreciate it. And most importantly, I want to give a public thank you to Donna Guinwa. Donna is my business partner here at the TV station. And in addition to that, every single idea that she has come up with, every single suggestion she has come up with, I've listened to, we have followed it, and it works seamlessly. So I just wanted to go on the record today and just say thank you, Donna. I really appreciate you.
Well, thank you, Jim. That is a true honor coming from you. And you know what? It goes right back to you because, Jim, you are brilliant. You are brilliant at what you do. You think things through methodically and with the heart of a servant, which is what we're all about. But it is rare, folks, that you will ever come across a man more giving with a bigger heart than Jim Grant.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate that. And before we get into our, what a wonderful summit we attended. We just got to pay a little bill here with the 6-minute webinar. We'll be right back right after this brief message.
A whole new level of clarity. That's what I received when I implemented the 6-minute webinar. Look, there's no shortage of things that you could be doing to grow your business, to grow your audience, to get your message out there. It's quite dizzying. However, when you get the perfect message in front of the right people, it has an amazing ability to get those folks into action. And so much that is out there distracts us from getting back to that message and finding that right person. With a 6-minute webinar, you can absolutely do that. Hi, my name is Dustin Matthews. I recently implemented the 6-minute webinar on my business and have seen amazing results, and I've gotten a whole new level of clarity. I highly, highly recommend you implement it in your business.
What's so funny, Donna? We just paid a bill there.
If you guys could see Jim dancing in the background, you'd be laughing with me.
Oh, yeah. She's laughing. She's literally laughing at my dancing. Let me say that, you know. Yeah, because I get up and I do something like kind of like a cross between the Watusi and the Boogaloo. We have to give a huge shout out to a dear friend of ours. She was on our show last week, this time on Thursday.
Yes.
Go ahead, Donna.
Vanya, oh my goodness. We were on Vanya's global summit. And when I say global, I mean global. It was amazing. It was the understanding the importance of water conservation and rainwater to help people who literally do not have running water. Women who are going out from villages in India and digging up mud and squeezing the water out of the mud for their families to have some water to drink. And of course, the impurities that come through that are horrific, and it does a toll on their entire body. And of course, I mean, everything from the inside out and the outside in. So Vanya has undergone this incredible task of helping people, villages obtain rainwater and filtration systems, which, you know, is a basic human need for every single one of us. I mean, we all need good pure water. And it was an incredible summit with speakers from around the globe giving their part of who they are and their due diligence, if you will, of how they can make a difference, no matter what they do as a business, but how they can make a difference in helping these people.
Oh, yeah. I was invited to speak on the Saturday because the Saturday summit was at this is the problem, and then had speakers, you know, identifying the problem and identifying the solution.
Right.
Well, since I don't know, I'm not a subject matter expert in, you know, the rainwater harvesting is what I'm trying to say. And, you know, the water conservationist. But I did give a speech on the community getting involved. And ladies and gentlemen, I tell you what, I used our very own 6-minute webinar. I did. And Donna used her 6-minute webinar for her speech.
Yes, I did.
And I'll tell you why we did it, because we only had a short period of time to talk. We didn't have 30 minutes, 45 minutes or anything like that. My talk was limited to about 12 minutes, 15 minutes, but you're able to get a very impactful presentation over, especially if you're going to speak somewhere. Because when you have a series of speakers like that, and then you have another person come on that speaks for 25, 30 minutes and goes on and on and on, it's obvious it's a disconnect. It really is. And so Donna and Charlene, as well as Tamara, they were going to speak on Sunday to more of the ladies who have to go out and do all this. And Donna, your topic was excellent. It was about how to find your higher energy and all that. And let me put your website up there and let you talk just a little bit about your high energy, and we'll continue on.
Well, great. Well, you know, really what I talked about was understanding that when we are in a negative space, no matter who you are, where you are in this world, when we are in a negative energy space, it breaks your immune system down. Okay. Yes. And understanding why you're in that negative space, what it is that is affecting you. So it really comes down to three things: a person, a place, or a thing. Mm-hmm. And it's about finding your triggers. If you do not find your triggers, you're not going to be able to get out of that space and come into a healthy way of living, which is from your heart. And understanding that getting rid of all the negative stuff in your life is really what sets you free. And it makes everyday life, everyday chores, even the most hated jobs that we have to do, it makes it okay because we are at peace within ourselves.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. And I felt real good about my presentation because the 6-minute webinar helped me deliver it in a very focused way.
Absolutely.
But to my surprise, on Sunday, now the way the time schedule worked over there, we were going live at 8 p.m. India Standard Time. And here in the United States, that would be 7:30 a.m. on the Pacific Coast and Pacific Time in Arizona. And it would be 10:30 a.m. on the East Coast.
Right.
So at about an hour before they go live on the second summit on Sunday, I get a message in from Vanya, and she wanted me to speak again. Well, I didn't know I was going to speak. She invited me to the summit again on Sunday, and I thought, okay. But then with my warped sense of humor, I had to give her, because I know how stressful putting on summits and events and all that and coordinating with people. I know how stressful that is. Right. And I told her, I'm out of makeup. My hair is a mess, but I'll come. And she really enjoyed, you know, a good laugh like that. But to my surprise, she asked me, I didn't know I was going to speak to her. She's already calling on me, you know, and so I was very, very honored. And the reason I share that with you is that gives you a clear picture of how powerful the 6-minute webinar is.
It really is, Jim.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. And I'll tell you right now, today we're going to talk about this. This is Dog Day Thursday. And I tell you, reading a story about this little dog, Balto, I'm going to set the scene of what was, you know, people were up against. It was in 1924. There was a, I'm trying to think of the doctor's name now. I can't think of it right now, but anyway, I had it on the tip of my tongue there. Yeah. He, what'd you say, Donna?
I was going to say if it's in my notes.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Anyway, Curtis Welch was the doctor, excuse me. And in 1924, several months before the Nome was all frozen in, this is Nome, Alaska we're talking about, he realized all of the medicine that he had on hand for diphtheria, this antitoxin, was expired. So he had put in for a brand new shipment, you know, send us more up here. And it didn't make it. And in December, he started treating a couple of kids that had sore throats. He thought it was tonsillitis and this and that. And that's when the panic happened, didn't it, Donna?
It did. It did. It was an outbreak. Mm-hmm. It was an outbreak. And it was pretty serious, because understand that by the time all of this started, it was 1925 and one of the worst storms Alaska mm-hmm. has ever seen on record. Mm-hmm. And the plane that was going to actually bring in the antitoxin medicine, they couldn't, because it was so dadgum cold and the winds were blowing so bad that it literally froze the plane's engine.
Yeah.
So now they're stuck with this medicine that needs to get to Nome, Alaska, and yet they can't get it there by the quickest way possible.
Yeah, because the medicine had made its way from Anchorage, Alaska, up to a little place, almost if I can pronounce this correctly. you want to try to take a stab at that?
Yeah. So as you can tell, Jim and I aren't too good with some names.
My glasses, I need to change them here. Maybe I get the high beams on here. Nenana.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's where it was.
Or Nenana. I'm not sure which.
Yeah. Anyway, that's where the medicine was. And there was no way to get up there except by dogs and sleds. And what's really amazing, now this entire trip, from Nenana up to Nome, they had to go north and follow along the Yukon River and go mm-hmm. up the coast there by the what they call Norton Sound before they get there. But you know how long that was? That was a 674-mile trip. Right. And in kilometers, that is 1,085 kilometers. It took them 5.5 days. There was a total of 20 mushers, you know, guys that run the dog sleds, and about 150 sled dogs. And Donna, my goodness, talk about cold. Ooh, my goodness gracious.
I've lived in the cold and it stinks. I don't like it at all. So, you know, my hat's off to them in what they did. I mean, this was back, folks, in 1925 when they mm-hmm. did not have we were not sophisticated in our clothing in order mm-hmm. to keep warm outside in such horrific conditions.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right, because it was minus 23 degrees. And that wind blowing, I mean, you can just imagine. It's one if it didn't freeze your lungs when you just inhaled. And that's where
they probably wore masks over their, you know, because I've actually done that, frozen my lungs, and it's not fun.
No, that's painful. My goodness. And, you know, it's, you know, the poor dogs, the way they got to, you know, hunker down at night, actually getting in the snow like that, you know, it kind of keeps them warm because it gets them insulated some. It takes a while to get warm, I imagine, but whew.
Well, here's the thing about huskies, Jim. Now, mm-hmm. a Siberian husky has two layers of fur. They've got, of course, their outer and their inner layer. And many dogs do, but because of the, they are an Arctic dog, their inner layer keeps them completely warm. It is a major insulation factor. Now, the other thing that is absolutely fascinating to me about a Siberian Husky is, of course, we all know that they're sled dogs, but one of the main reasons they are is a good Husky can pull over 40% of its body weight. So I have a Great Pyrenees Husky mix, and I guarantee you, it's a fact. That boy is 11 years old and can pull you around the yard like you were a little two-pound toy.
I hear you, you know, and, you know, when those dogs are like that, because, you know, Mother Nature has a way of protecting her babies, because I remember out in Arizona, I had a little goat, and I did not realize how cold it was going to get, but I went out there one day, I looked at her and I thought, man, she's really getting a lot of fur on her body. And it was like a woolly little coat, and she needed it. That's for sure. But Mother Nature has a way of taking care of them. Well, let's get back to our story here on little Balto. He was, it's like you say, a Siberian Husky, and he received a lot of fame because I think he completed the last 25 miles. Did he not, Donna?
He did. It was the last 25 miles of the journey.
He was the lead sled dog, which is the critical dog in a sled in a pack like that. And the diphtheria the breakout there of diphtheria, my goodness gracious, those people were, the dogs was the only hope. You couldn't get
it. It was the only way.
Yeah, it was the only way. That's all those poor people had was a dog sled. Right. And, you know, and plus the guys who toughed it out in that type of, you know, atmosphere and all. And when you think about that, one of the things that comes to mind, and that is the principle of going the extra mile. Many times in our life, we quit when the going gets a little tough, or if it gets too cold, or if we get too grumpy or something of this nature. We just don't like it, do we, Donna?
No. But it brings up a great point, Jim, in going that extra mile, because not only did every one of the mushers who participated go the extra mile to make this happen and to save that community and therefore other communities from this horrific disease, but every one of those dogs did. Every single one of those dogs did. They went the extra mile and they pushed themselves, each one of those dogs, under abnormally cold conditions.
Yeah. Brutal conditions.
Oh, absolutely.
I remember in 1969, we were in Grafenwehr, Germany, and that's over by the Czech border. And we were up in the mountains, and this is January, February, 1969, with snow on the ground, sleeping in tents. And I'm telling you, if you want to be miserable, that's a good way to do it, because you never get warm.
Right.
You never get warm. And, you know, when you think about going the extra mile like everyone had to, and I think dogs have that unique ability to be able to pick up that, hey, this is important. And then they become, you know, literally a team player in that. And that's exactly what little Balto did. And he was an international star, because when this outbreak of the disease was happening and all of this was going on, there was coverage all over the world, wasn't there, Donna?
There was, because this was so critical in stopping a pandemic from happening, quite frankly. Diphtheria is so contagious that they knew they had to do something to stop it. Otherwise, a complete pandemic would wipe out an entire town and probably surrounding towns after that.
Can you imagine the faith that those mushers had to have in their dogs, in themselves? Right. And look at the things we can learn about applying faith in our life. I'm not talking about religion, but I'm talking about having the faith that you can do something, that you've got the gift and the talent. That's really critical, isn't it?
It is critical. And it's understanding that, you know, your vision, just because somebody else doesn't see your vision, doesn't mean it's not valid. Right?
That's right.
And not letting somebody else defeat you before you've even got started, Jim.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. Because many times in life, people, well, it's like old Henry Ford made that great comment, if you think you can or if you think you can't, you're right. Yeah. And it's funny because I love what you do there in teaching people about energy and the energy comes in from the, you know, when you're out of balance, you know, with energy, your body's out of balance, you're out of balance from the universe, internal, all the way around, the full spectrum. And, you know, when it comes to, you know, what you do and the energy that's required, my goodness gracious. I mean, it just seems like all the real problems just fall away and you're able to, you know, accomplish things. And most importantly, have a clear mind on the objective and the goal.
Absolutely. You have a definite sense of purpose, which is, you know, everybody who was partaking in getting the medicine, the anti-venom or toxin, antitoxin to Nome, Alaska, had a definition of purpose, including each one of those dogs. And those dogs, we all know how dogs can feel, you know, our emotions, right? I mean, Jim, you're a dog owner. I'm a dog owner. Well, those dogs felt the urgency and that energy from the mushers who were handling them on that sled. And so the, you know, their definition of purpose was to do the job at hand. And that's what we have to remember as, you know, entrepreneurs, as business owners, and just as people, mom, dad, whatever it is we're doing, that we have a definite purpose in life and don't give up.
You're exactly right. And one of the things also that I think is really missed, can be very, very easily missed in this story, and we don't normally associate this with dogs, but you got those sled dogs, you got that one musher, and they're out there and they're all alone. You better believe teamwork plays a big part of their success, working together as a team.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. They have to be able to know and trust each other implicitly. And that's where the, you know, the musher and all of the sled dogs have a relationship and no commands. And that's where the lead dog comes into play, because he's the one, or she, whichever the case may be. But they're the ones who plow through the hard stuff, and they're the ones who are usually the strongest and usually the quickest to think on their feet.
In addition to that, they're also trained to the point, and we don't normally think of dogs having self-discipline, but yes, they do. And that's one thing that, you know, that, because that lead dog, it's got to have the vision to see which way they go, the right path.
Correct.
And don't run them up, you know, where there's stumps in the snow and stuff like that. And I don't know very much about sled dogs, but I mean, I do know that sled dog is the lead dog. He's the all-seeing eye for that entire sled run. That's how important it is, and that's what little Balto did. The last 25 miles, I'm just still sitting here, and ladies and gentlemen, I'm just still kind of trying to process that they went 674 miles, the 20 mushers and about 150 dogs, 674 miles in 5.5 days. Now, what's interesting, you know, when you think about something like that, in the old West, when cowboys got on their horses and rode off in the sunset, which I don't think anybody wanted to do that in their right mind. I think it's made up of Hollywood. Yeah, it's getting dark. I think I'm going to head out of here, you know. But on a good day, they could ride 30 to 35 miles. And these sled dogs, they had to go through the most brutal conditions you can imagine.
Oh, absolutely. Talk about controlled attention. Controlled attention. I mean, this was honestly, back in 1925, I'm not 100% sure, but I think I'm about 97% sure, maybe. But they didn't have the dog pads, you know, the little shoes for the dog's feet that we do now. So, you know, they had salve and stuff that they helped the dogs when their feet got cut on ice. And you know, any of us who've ever been in the snow or ice know that an ice cut hurts just as bad as anything else out there. And, you know, that's their little feet. So they had to take care of their feet. And that's one of the things that I know for a fact that mushers do is always check their dog's feet, check to make sure that they're in good health all the way. But their controlled attention, Jim, that is so applicable to what it is we each as humans do every single day.
Mm-hmm. Exactly right, because it's a prerequisite. And as you were talking there, I was thinking about how important sound mental health is.
Mm-hmm.
Because, goodness, if you start out, you know, on any kind of a project and you're already defeated in your mind, there's no way your mind will let you fail and, you know, and be a winner, because your mind will deliver to you exactly what you're thinking. And that's always, you know, that's been one thing. It seems like I know a lot of people don't get, you know, realize that much. I didn't realize it that much for many years, but I realize it now that your mind, it attracts what you want. It will repel what you don't want.
Correct.
And the choice is yours.
Oh, absolutely. It's always a choice. It's a choice in what we do. So if you choose to continue on and get through it and succeed, you will succeed. Mm-hmm. But if you choose to just give up and say, well, gosh, this is just too hard, that's going to happen. And, you know, I'm personally so thankful that in this case of all these mushers and these dogs, that nobody gave up. They worked as a giant team, controlling their attention for the one thing that mattered. So basically, without them knowing it, back in 1925, they had a mastermind, Jim.
Yes, they did.
They had a mastermind, and they said, okay, this is what we've got to do. This is how many miles we have to go in order to get the medicine there.
Oh, yeah. And the thing that you were talking about that came to my mind was the fact that, think about the servant heart they had.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't think about the hardships they were going to face. They didn't think about some of the problems they're going to face. And you know they faced problems. Oh, they had to overcome different things. But their focus was on getting this precious medicine up there to Nome and help put out that, you know, disease that was going to spread like wildfire.
Oh, yeah. It's diphtheria. It is incredibly contagious, incredibly contagious.
And especially during that time of year, where's everybody at?
Inside.
Indoors.
Right. Inside. But, you know, they created their own vision, Jim. And this is something that you know, you talked about, creating your own vision in your head of succeeding. And each one of them created their own vision that their portion in getting that medicine there was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, and going back and reading it, there was accidents along the way and there was delays and there was things that happened that, you know, they had no control of. And you know what? Bottom line is we don't have a lot of control in everything we do every single day in life, but we do have creative vision control.
We sure do.
Get you from point A to point B.
You're exactly right. And, you know, and one of the things for us humans, when we're, since we've been talking about the dogs, for us humans, one of the things that's very, very critical in our life to be able to be successful and be able to attract the right people to create a mastermind, a teamwork, you've got to have a pleasing personality. Because if you don't have a pleasing personality, I mean, who wants to hang around with a grump? You know, I mean, really, you know.
It's kind of like, true.
Yeah, it reminds me of the story about this husband and wife. They were having, you know, problems in their marriage. So one day she goes to the counselor to see the counselor by herself because they were seeing the counselor individually. And the counselor says, how did you wake? Did you wake up grumpy this morning? And she says, no, I let him sleep. And that's not funny enough in the story now.
It's a little funny, Jim. It's a little funny, but it is true because, you know, we've all been around those people, Jim, that you walk into a meeting, you're at work, you're at a speaking event, whatever the case may be. And there is somebody who has really negative, toxic energy.
Oh, yeah.
And you see them and you immediately think, I don't want anything to do with him. You know, I got to get out of here. I don't want to be by him. And same token, we've all been around those people who have such a dynamic personality that energy is just almost electrifying around them. And you're drawn to them because you want to be around people who are good and promote great energy. And that is a pleasing personality.
A good example of this, and this is not, this is more a little bit more in the physical, but whenever someone is struggling financially and they look a little worried or, you know, and they give off that negative vibe, and people, they'll stay away from that because they might figure it's like this, you know, disease, this pandemic, it's catching, you know?
Right.
And then I've known guys and I've seen them, you know, that they've been very, maybe they had to, you know, couple of good months or whatever, been very successful and they're, you know, very happy because they've made a lot of sales and all that. And they attract people just like a street light will attract the little bugs at night. It's just something about that. And so you've got to have a pleasing personality. And to do that, maintain that, you've got to maintain your sound mental and physical health. And that's what Donna's been talking a lot with her program that she has, you know, the high energy, and like she's a high energy coach. And if you go to, you know, her website there, donnaguinois.com, and she'll be glad to, you know, talk to you and, you know, give you a, maybe a free 30 minute, consultation, whatever, you know.
Absolutely. You know, the other thing is that understanding that nobody, Jim, none of us get anywhere in this world by ourselves.
That's right.
Right? We are not meant to be alone and go through life with nobody in our corner. And so it doesn't matter what it is you're doing. If you need help, reach out. Reach out to the people who can help you, who say they want to help you. And those people will have a servant's heart. They're not going to judge you. They're not going to say, well, gee, I realize you're in a bad way right now, but, you know, for $59,000, I'll help you. You know, so you want to be around people who have a servant's heart and are willing to show you and help you.
You're exactly right. When you talk about a servant's heart and all that, the person came to my mind was Don McGrath. Don is exactly that. In fact, I just saw a video Don made, you know, about if you don't give a refund, I mean, a guarantee for a refund, you know, you're missing the boat, because that is one of the things that's very critical. And I remember when I started back working a little bit on the internet, it was back around 2008 or nine, something like that. And I was working on the internet, going to be working on some sales and stuff like that. And I wanted to get smarter. So I listened to a couple people and I decided to buy this one guy's product for $999. And so I get it in. Came in, you know, some CD-ROMs they sent. And so I get the thing in, and I'm looking at this thing, and I'm looking at it and looking at it. The best way I can describe it to you in a simple way, it's kind of like getting a box that's got 1,000 pieces of, you know, puzzle, 1,000-piece puzzle. And you open a box, There's no picture on the box now, okay? Got to keep that in mind. It's just a gray, plain box cover. And inside, it says, find the four corner pieces and all the straight pieces and put all of them together. And then the next step, all you got to do is put the rest of them inside there and fit them together, and you'll be done.
Right.
And I'm going like, you know, I don't know about this, because a guy had two programs. He had a $9.99. He had the $14.99.
Oh, my goodness.
So I called him back. And I told him, I said, you know, this is not really working out for me. I just don't have a good vibe about this. Uh-huh. And he says, oh, well, what you need my $1,499. And I'm going like, well, if I don't understand the $1,000, how am I going to understand it at $1,500?
Right.
I mean, you know. And I said, well, I'd rather just go ahead, if it's okay with you, and return it. And because I just don't think that this is what I'm looking for.
Right, right.
And he let me know in the little disclaimer box that all sales have. And it wasn't in bold print, but over here it said, all sales
are final.
Next line, are final.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because he knew his product was not worth anything.
Correct. Absolutely correct. And those are the kind of people that you want to stay away from.
Yes. Yeah, because, you know, when people try to, you know, cheat people out of money and stuff like that, they don't realize the only person they're really cheating is themselves.
Absolutely.
They're enslaving themselves.
Mm-hmm. As you say, Jim, they're trying to butter their own bread.
Mm-hmm. And there's going to be a heavy, heavy price for them to pay for that. And when I think about, you know, how much accurate thinking that these mushers and these sled dogs have to have. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, it's amazing, because I was watching a little bit about the sled dogs here several years ago, and how the mushers, they know which dog to put where.
Right. Based on their strength, their personality, because mm-hmm. just like people, some dogs don't get along with other dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Just yeah. because they're all in that team doesn't mean that you can put, you know, this dog with this dog. And mm-hmm. if you do, they'll fight. So yeah. they know to put, you know, to separate them and put them, which one gives the other one, complements the other one in their physical and mental abilities.
Right. You're exactly right. And when we're talking about that, the thing comes to mind is that we've all seen the geese. In the wintertime, I love to hear the geese, because you can stand out there watching them go by. You can actually hear the flap of their wings as they fly overhead.
Right.
And it amazes me how they change formation. Mm-hmm. But the way they fly in that formation, each bird, each goose, has a unique function. And that is to help to break the wind, and it takes less effort for all of them to fly along in that V formation.
Right.
And then when the lead bird gets a little tired, he'll drop out, and they automatically know what, you know, how to make that. It just amazes me. It really is. And of course, with you know, the dog sleds there and the team and all that, that's where the musher, he's got to know his dogs.
Mm-hmm.
He's got to be able to, you know, put his dogs in a situation to be successful.
Right.
And as an entrepreneur, that's one of the things that you have to do with your clients. You got to know them well enough that you'll be able to set them up, meet their needs, and help them be successful. That's critical.
It is.
Yeah, because so many people are just instant next sale, aren't they, Donna?
Right. Or you'll attend a networking event that's supposed to be a big thing. And then when it ends, there's no meat with the potatoes,
yeah.
right? So you want to be able to, you know, set yourself up to give to your clients
mm-hmm.
Not only meat and potatoes, but you want to be able to bring them the dessert too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Because when they come to you looking for help, they're only wanting to know one thing, and that was one thing only. Can you help me now?
Right.
Can you stop my pain? Can you help me create sales? Whatever it might be, that's what they're looking for. And that really is the real benefit and the true value of the 6-minute webinar, because we've all attended these webinars where people go on and on and on forever. But in that 6-minute webinar, the first sentence, you've attracted your ideal client.
Yep.
And you repelled all the other ones who cannot help, because, you know, it's just, you just ask a simple question.
Right.
You know, or tell them, you know, that during this 6-minute webinar, I will teach you 3 ways to do bang, bang, bang.
Right.
And if you're interested in those things, go ahead, Donna.
I'm sorry. I was just going to say the 6-minute webinar is beautiful because it goes right in with, and we've all heard it, over deliver and under promise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Don't promise the moon and the stars if you can't deliver it.
Yeah. And I did my talk on that Saturday there at the summit, the Water Conservation Rainwater Harvesting Summit in India. And I'm convinced that since I used the six minute webinar for my presentation, I'm convinced that's why Vanya wanted me to come back in on Sunday.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
But if I'd have got on TV and sounded like a clown, you know, I mean, because really, you know, she wants, if you're going to be a speaker or whatever, keep this in mind. This is critical. How can you make the event coordinator look good to their audience?
Right. Mm-hmm. It's about making them shine.
Mm.
Make them shine.
Yeah.
And by making, and it's what we talk about all the time, Jim, when you make other people shine. Okay. So when you're blessing somebody else, mm-hmm. those blessings will come back to you.
Oh yeah.
They always, always come back to you.
They certainly do. And it's just amazing because we, you know, every time I hear a speaker who is a typical old school pitch man,
you're right. Used car salesman.
Yeah, they get up there and they're, "Hi, how's everybody doing today?" And you know, "I'm so glad to be here." Well, whoop de doo, you know. And I'm a coach. I'm a writer. I do this. I've done that. And let me tell you what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to sell you something today.
Right.
That's basically what WIT comes across. And we come up there, and this is from the teachings that Don McGrath teaches there at the Scale Pathway. He's also the co-owner of the 6-minute webinar. He's the doctor behind the 6-minute webinar. The other good man there is Bill Heinrich. Bill is actually the dean of the 6-minute webinar. But between those two, yeah, and like Don says, I give my vision statement and my mission statement when someone wants my bio.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, I don't have to tell my, you know, he don't talk about his successes in life. I mean, the man holds 36 U.S. patents. And I mean, there'd be a lot of people.
How many books has he written? Countless.
Don has written 6 books that's been on the line. Yeah, and he's written other things too. But he says,
right.
He says, as an author, I've written 6 books, 4 good ones and 2 stinkers. You know? And, you know, you hear all these people say over and over again, I'm a best-selling, you know, author, you know. And
right.
If I've often thought about, because you know my warped sense of humor, you're getting up there and saying, ladies and gentlemen, I am a worst-selling author. In fact, New York Times, Amazon, everybody else says, don't call us, we'll call you. I mean, just to break the ice and be funny, you know, just Absolutely. Say something different. I mean, goodness gracious. And
But the point you're trying to make, Jim, is nobody wants to hear anybody talk about I. Mm-hmm. Look at me. Oh, did you know this about me? Look at me. Because mm-hmm. people don't remember what you say. People will always remember how you make them feel.
Mm, you're right. I like that. And we've went a little bit over as far as paying the bills, but we'll pay a quick bill here. We've got one of our good friends, a tremendous young lady, Angel Marie Monticelli, and she talks about the 6-minute webinar. When her parents named her Angel, it was the perfect name for her.
It was.
Hi, I'm Angel Marie Monticelli with Angel Marie Shines. And I had the pleasure, the honor to go through training for the 6-minute webinar. Oh my gosh, this webinar and how it's structured and how they teach it. Thank you, Speakers Pathway Coalition. Thank you, Don McGrath and the whole team for the 6-minute webinar, because you made it so simple, easy. And the way you lined it out with the outline, I can reproduce it. And I'm already getting the engagement. I'm getting people that are coming back. They're saying, oh, I love this webinar that's so short, so to the point, and I love your products and what I'm selling, but then what I'm also, the services that I provide, and I don't want any of this because I have the framework. So thank you so much to the whole team, because the 6-minute webinar totally rocks. Thank you.
I tell you, that's amazing. We have a lot of fun when behind the scenes there, and Donna's doing all these things to crack me up. It's all her fault, you know. So,
oh, don't listen to him. It's him that's cracking me up, folks.
I tell you, we have a lot of fun on this show because people enjoy infotainment along with good information, and my stomach is not what it should be today, so I apologize for that. But one of the things that we haven't touched on yet. Donna, how important is a positive mental attitude in life?
Oh my gosh, it's one of the most important things that we can take with us every single day. Mm-hmm. You know, the more I look at it like this, Jim, the more technology we have at our fingertips, it's a blessing, but it's also a curse, because it gives us so much information that it can kind of do a reverse effect, and we get an overload. And so then we get really grumpy and we don't have that positive mental attitude. And so finding that balance for positive mental attitude in your life is critical, and it will balance your entire life.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. Also too, excuse me, the having a positive mental attitude, it attracts what you want in life. Mm-hmm. It will repel everything that you don't want in life.
Right.
And right. I heard a question asked one time, and this will hear, it shocked me. And talking about that, this guy is, this true story. I mean, this guy's a preacher, and he says, remember one thing. He says, you'll only be tempted with what you store in your heart. And you think about that for a moment. You're like, okay, I wouldn't, never got tempted to do drugs or rob banks or anything like that. But what you do get tempted with is what you store in your heart. And so that's why it's so critical to have the right kind of heart if you want to have a positive attitude, if you want to live healthy, if you want to enjoy the true riches of life.
Right.
It all begins with the heart, and the heart is where we, you know, we're talking about the heart of the soul now, not the blood pump in the chest, but that's where all love begins. And that's the creation of life. Number one, number two, that's what maintains you in a healthy lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. It does. Mm-hmm. It does. There's I believe it's a Cherokee. I don't know if it's just a proverb or something, but it's called two wolves, and it's really critical in what you're saying, Jim. So this grandfather is teaching his grandson about life, and he looks at his grandson and he says, grandson, there is a fight going on inside me. He said, and this is a really bad one. He says, inside me is living anger and bitterness and hate and confusion and jealousy. And at the same time, there's another one, a wolf inside me that is good and kind and wants to share and give and receive love. And he says, the same fight, grandson, is living inside you and everybody else. And so his grandson looks at him and says, well, Grandpa, which one wins? And his grandfather looks at him and says, whichever one you feed the most.
Mm-hmm. That is so true. I love that saying.
I do too.
It's very, very accurate in life.
It is.
It's imperative in life for you to make sure you feed the right wolf in your life, because there is good and evil, and there is a war within. There's no question about that.
Right.
And if you want to live a good, sound, and mental and healthy life, physical life, I mean, it's a prerequisite.
It is. And, you know, when you do live a really healthy, positive life, what you're going to find is you have more enthusiasm, Jim.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love what you say. For those of you who don't know, and Jim won't mind me saying, he'll say, people ask me, well, Jim, you're past retirement age. When are you going to just stop working altogether? And he says, listen to him. And he'll tell you, the day before I die.
Yeah. Yeah. That's exactly right, because where else can I go and be on TV, enjoy myself, love myself, and crack Don up and make her snort on TV?
Yeah, he does.
But it's just a joy and a jubilee to be here. And one of the greatest blessings that I think that we get is that when people tell us how they enjoy the show.
Oh,
that's just, it's just off the chart.
And when we've touched somebody's life and mm-hmm. made a difference, I mean, that's what Jim and I are here to do every week, mm-hmm. to touch somebody's life and to make a difference, to impact you. And, you know, we are always here, even though we're here as hosts, but we're here as a resource. Mm-hmm. And Jim and I would like everybody to know that if you are struggling to find maybe that right resource in your life, reach out to us, and if we can at all, we will help you. We will put you in the right direction, in mm-hmm. contact with somebody who would be able to help you.
And that is a public service that we provide. We don't, get a percentage from anybody we refer you to or anything like that.
No.
I've had people say, well, you know, if you refer people to me, I'll give you a percentage. And I said, well, just take that off of the price and give it back to the person that's buying it, because it defeats the purpose of being a good servant. It really does.
And that's just not how Jim and I operate.
Mm-mm, not at all. And if you want to email Donna there at highenergyrightnow@gmail.com, she'll be glad to help you. You can email both of us at theinspiration@e360tv.com. And that's our email here at the TV station. So our staff will make sure that we get it. And any way we can help you with whatever, just like in the summit, I told people out there, I have a program that helps neighbor get his neighbors or her neighbors united.
Mm-hmm.
And how to get them motivated and how to get them to, you know, see what you see. And, of course, a lot of it comes from just listening to what they say and how they feel. Because when it comes to bettering your neighborhood or something like that, everybody wants to chip in.
Absolutely.
But it's got to be approached the right way. I approach it the wrong way, but I learned how. And I want to that's my free gift to you. Also, I also have another free gift, especially for you folks that suffer from glossophobia. Now, when you say that in public, you know, real close, actually, if I remember correctly, I said it one time when I was talking to some people. I said, you know, I have had and I help people that suffer from glossophobia. And subconsciously, people started backing up, doing that, you know, keeping that safe distance 6 feet away long before we ever heard of COVID-19. But glossophobia is the fear of public speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And glosso means, it's a Greek word for tongue. And so I suffered through that for many years and overcome it. So if I can help you there, it's my free gift. Just email us here at inspiration360tv. We'll be glad to get that out to you. And Donna, I tell you right now, that little dog, we got to finish up about him. We got to talk about his life after he became such a celebrity. Yes, my goodness gracious, he lived a very nice, comfortable life in retirement.
He did. He actually lived at the Cleveland Zoo in comfort, in ease. He had the life of Riley, if you will, until he you know, died of natural causes. But what an incredible dog. He was also there at the unveiling. This was, I thought, was so cute. He was there at the unveiling of his own statue.
Yep. That's really amazing. And nowadays, of course, after he died, he was mounted, and he is in the Cleveland Museum of Natural History. I mean, you think about this little dog that was born in the northwest part of the Alaska Territory. He's from Nome, pretty close up there. And you would think, how could a little dog there go all the way to where he is, where he wound up and became a hero. And he just, there's no doubt about it, Donna. There is no doubt about it. That dog knew the importance of the mission.
He did.
And that's important with, if you're working with people, if you're supervising people, whatever you're doing, they've got to understand the importance of the mission.
Yep. And he had a heart, Jim.
Oh, yeah.
He had a heart. And he was innately just a good dog. And, you know, that was one of the things that in reading about this story that I love is when I read about dogs, and, of course, I'm a huge, huge animal lover. But when I read about dogs and their heart, what can I learn from these incredible animals? Because, you know, dog is just God spelled backwards. So what can we, you know, what can we learn from the heart of these dogs and how they look and look at life and how they took on their role in, in being a hero?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, when those people heard that those dogs were out there, you know, those people, hey, look, because that would be, that's hope out there. That's exciting hope. We got hope now.
That's applied faith.
And you know exactly, you're right, Donna. You know exactly. People rushed out there and those dogs picked up on that. And they knew they had done good. Because dogs can look at you sometime if they got a frown on your face and they'll kind of like, okay, I think I'm going to give him a little space till he, you know, in case he blows a head gasket or something. But, you know, like another great example of how dogs can reason and pick up on things is that I've known dogs and I've gotten a couple animals, as a matter of fact, not dogs, but cats from the animal shelter. But I was going through this area and they had these dogs out there and they were wanting to adopt them and all that from the animal shelter. But I was, you know, didn't have a need for a dog then. I was, you know, a few hundred miles home. But this one dog looked at me. And he's kind of like trying to catch my attention. He says, I think I want to pick this guy here. And, you know, just if I could have took him home, if I, you know, without getting, you know, talked to, I would have done it, you know. But it's amazing how they pick up on that. And Donna, you know well how well that it's a great way to teach kids love and responsibility in it.
Oh, yeah. My children grew up with animals and lots of cats and dog. And they it taught my children responsibility and how to give to somebody else without ever asking for anything back.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And what they got back was far more valuable. They got unconditional love by every animal that ever came through my house.
Oh, yeah. It's really amazing because, you know, we've heard the saying that some people say, and it's been said many times, but many people that they say that the more I know about people, the more I love my dogs.
You're right.
And dogs are just that. They're just loving animals and they're serving animals. And we could all take a big lesson from the dogs, having that kind of heart and everything. Well, ladies and gentlemen, our time's about gone. And
it is up.
Yeah, I mean to tell you, we just went over the 1 hour mark, so we better get on out of here. But I just want to hope and pray that the show we delivered today has been a blessing to you. And most importantly, remember that you've got to love yourself first, then you can love others, because you can only share something that you own. On behalf of Donna and myself, thank you so much for tuning in. Be sure and share the show with others. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.